Next, I'd like to bring up Liang from Qualcomm. So he had a presentation to give. All right. And also, he's going to show the Dragon Board, a little bit of it. You brought one? It's teeny tiny. All right, cool. All right, then, take it away.
Yeah, it's not too hard to bring one of these with me. I always joke about in my previous career, I used to deal with PCs and big gaming PCs. So if I was gonna come here and do a demo, I'd probably need like a big suitcase and call people to help me up the stairs. But now I just get to throw it in my pocket and bring it in. So one of the perks of working in mobile industry, I would say. So thanks again. I really appreciate you guys coming in and you know, the event for having us. I'm not going to spend too much time because we have some exciting presentations for you guys. I thought I'd maybe do a quick recap of what my colleague talked about last time that we're here. How many of you guys, by the way, were here for the first part of this three presentation series? Anybody? Oh, all right. So, should I do the whole presentation? all right. So yeah. So the last kind of the first leg of the series was August 26th, where my colleague came in and talked about what Qualcomm is doing for the sort of the development part of this space. You know, how do I get started? How do I, if I'm creating a device or if I have an idea, what is the first step? So we talked about that. That's where that little guy came in. So my colleague Kayla was here, and she went into the details of the board. Today, I'm very excited to have two companies that have actually created things, and they're gonna tell you how they went about designing it. And then in the third one, which is on October 7th, we're going to have a couple of companies that are going to tell you sort of about the last mile, which is, okay, now I developed something, I got the idea, I have kind of the product, now I've got a prototype and actually create hardware. How do I do that? So really kind of, I think the three steps that everybody goes through before you actually become commercial. I like this slide because everybody talks about IoT. Who knows what IoT is? Okay, you guys are ahead of me, I don't know what it is. Everybody talks about it differently. Some people talk about apps and services, some people talk about devices. So it's just, it's a very broad space. And that's why you see so many different numbers. I mean, everybody, what is the highest one, 19 trillion? My estimate is 100 trillion. I think everybody is right. It's a huge market, and there's so many things we can do. How does Qualcomm see it? For us, it's the diversity of this market. And if you look at if you look at the different types of things that people are doing, some of it just has nothing to do with each other. There's so many different verticals, so many different things that people are calling IoT. So, the way I see it is there's it's a diversity in this market, and how do we approach it? What do we have to do to capture kind of the scale of this market? So, for Qualcomm, again, I'm speaking for Qualcomm, but I think to some extent this is true. We have these two, I would say, mutually dependent kind of types of businesses. One is on the intelligent side of things, so processing, anything to do with CPUs, GPUs, DSPs, sensor processing, all that stuff, displays, location, all those things, kind of the intelligence part of things. And then there's the connectivity part of things, so Bluetooth, Wi-Fi, all the different types of connectivity, the different types of connectivity that we have, and how do you kind of marry these two things together to create a product or create a solution? So from our perspective, it's how do we get these two things to now work together? So this might be interesting to you guys. I didn't say this, it's a Gartner quote, but they expect that percentage, that higher percentage to come from those startups. So how many of you guys would categorize yourself in that category? Startups less than 3 years old. Yeah, quite a few. So a lot of opportunity, but I think here's the challenge. When you have a whole bunch of startups that are coming into this space, everybody's very new in doing this stuff. So when we looked at this, we said, okay, what do we need to do to help maybe some of these newer startups? May not have a lot of experience designing for complicated platforms or those type of things. So what do we do? What can we do to help? So this is this is that to me, and I think we talked about this in the last version or the last part of this is all about the maker. And there's this obviously the maker movement. You guys maker fair, So what we decided to do is if we can create something that the makers like and works for them, then it's going to be something that everybody else can take advantage of and can use to build things. So this is the list. This is what personally I've been working on for the past 5 years or so at Qualcomm. And the interesting thing was when I first started, we were creating these platforms for mobile developers. And a lot of mobile developers who are maybe they're creating new cameras or new sensors or new displays. They were using platforms that my team was providing them. But we used to get every now and then somebody would use those platforms to create something other than a phone. And it wasn't happening every day, but it was happening frequent enough that we kind of got, we were disappointed to always say, no, we can't use our chip, because our chip is just for mobile. So that was kind of the first, I would say, kind of how we started this whole thing of how do we get our chip, which is Snapdragon, was kind of came out of the whole mobile revolution. There's, as you guys know, your phone from 5 years ago probably can't even recognize it as a phone. So all the things that we've been putting into these mobile processors over these last few years, people are coming in and saying, look, I can use that same chipset. I'm not going to go create another chipset or another SoC when this one already is there and Qualcomm is investing in it. So we got tired of saying, no, you can't use our chip. We didn't say no because we were bored. We said no because there was really no easy way for people to use our chip. It was basically kind of single purpose for the mobile space. So over the last 5 years or so, we've been working on every single one of these things, starting from leveraging the functionality of the mobile chipset, all the way to adding accessible software, for example, Linux. A lot of people will come in and say, yeah, Android is great, but all the things that I do, I use Linux. So we need to create Linux builds, like an Ubuntu build for Snapdragon. Also extended documentation. When you have just a handful of mobile customers, you don't create very, very good documentation because you have a lot of engineers. But when you're dealing with thousands of different companies, you need to give them good documentation. So all the things that you see here are the things that we've been working on. And part of that same strategy was this guy, Dragon Board. So how do you guys use the community board? Raspberry Pi, maybe? That rings a bell. Now, we didn't create this because we wanted to be Raspberry Pi. It's actually not a Raspberry Pi. It has no intention of being a Raspberry Pi. We created this because we wanted to create a board for people who want to do some serious stuff. So this has a very powerful processor, but also built-in Wi-Fi, GPS, and Bluetooth. So this goes back to what I talked about. We wanted to combine intelligence and connectivity into one board. So that was the idea. We launched this about a few months ago, and if you guys want to check it out, I think I have some links up here. So actually, I have some links on the last slide. But the idea was, if you want to start development, if you want to start prototyping, you would go get one of these boards whether it's from Aero. And then this is supported by community. So there's a community called 96 Boards, which was created by Lenaro. I don't know if you guys know Lenaro. They actually have an event next week here, Lenaro Connect, if you guys are interested in that. But what they created is they created a kind of an open standard. So this is open hardware, open software for kind of higher end SoCs that are based on the ARM instruction set. So that's what, you know, we were one of the first boards based on that standard. Dragon Board 410C was actually one of the first boards. And the idea is that you can take this board or any of the other 96 boards, and the people are going to create all these accessory cards called mezzanines that you can add additional functionality. So one of the first ones that's going to come out is one with all the sensors and all the motor control, if you're doing, for example, drones or robotics is an example. So that's going to be a great community. They're also creating, obviously, software and different types of middleware on top of these boards. And then the next step, if you want to now take your product and actually commercialize it, we don't just throw a chip at you and say, go and do something with it. We have all these partners that are going to help you, whether it's, you know, you could still use a chip and do your own design, or you can start with a module that's production ready. So that module, you can just go get that module and then build your product around it. So you don't have to worry about, you know, designing something complicated. I mean, I used to be a board designer, and when I look at, you know, how complicated these designs are, you know, high speed design, high speed memory, high speed SoC, and you try to create a board that actually works, is very difficult. So having those modules, those production-ready modules, is a key part of that second step. And then eventually, you know, you go to Kickstarter or wherever it is, or VCs, and you get your product into the market. It can be as simple as that, as long as we have the right partners in place and the right solutions in place, and obviously making it accessible and all those things that I have on that slide. So with that, you guys can probably, we probably have these on the site, but basically there's a page where you can go see some of the things that we're doing with the, you know, putting Snapdragon into the embedded space. There's a page where on developer.qualcomm.com where you can go find out more about Dragon Board. And then I threw this in here because we're going to be in another event, and our partners are going to be there as well next week at the TechCrunch. So if you guys are going to be there, I'll be happy to chat some more with you guys, and I'll be here as well. So with that, let me introduce one of my favorite people, Nemo Shams. It's interesting that I get to introduce Nemo, because when we first started this, and when we first started this whole program, there was a few people that we had said no to, but they were persistent. They said, look, your chip is good, you want to use it, you know. When we found out about these guys, they convinced us on how good they are, we went and checked out their stuff, and my mind was blown, what these guys are doing and how, what type of designs that they worked on. Using Snapdragon should be a piece of cake. So they're one of the first ones, before we were even ready with our program, to jump in and take Snapdragon and create something mind-blowing out of it. So it's my pleasure to announce Nemo Shams from ODG.
first of all, sorry for missing the Republican debate over there. I know Donald Trump's very interesting, so I appreciate that you guys attended. Hi, my name is Nima Shams. We are, like Leon said, one of the most persistent people that were part of the program. I kept bugging Leon saying, we're making what we believe to be the next disruptive platform. And so we kept asking Leon, Snapdragon is a perfect fit for our ecosystem. So this is totally open. If you guys have questions at any time, feel free to interrupt me. I'm going to walk through Headworn. It's become a very hot space. Our company's been working on it for 6 years. We've invested $80 million into it. We started out of our CEO's loft, and now we own a full floor across from the ballpark, including a clean room in Soma. So, you know, any dream and any vision can become reality, but, you know, persistence and clear direction. And so I'm going to give you guys a snapshot of who we are, what our product is, and then do a quick walkthrough of a design, and feel free to ask questions. We also brought some goodies to kind of show what our product is. Okay? So intro, Headworn market, the challenges, mini case study, and a demo. So who's ODG? What's ODG? ODG stands for Osterhout Design Group. Our CEO, Ralph Osterhout, is a brilliant inventor. Google him, he has Wikipedia pages on him. He made underwater submarines for James Bond movies. He did the Yak Back in Home Alone. He's done toys for Uncle Sam and toys for Mattel. So he's just this brilliant inventor. 6 years ago, he had a vision about what the future of Headworn was. And that future was something that will disrupt the market, something we believe would be the next evolution of phones. We're 80 people, 34,000 square feet right across from Soma. There's a picture of our clean room right there. And we are privately held, so no VCs, no investors, no nothing. My name is Nima Shams. I run the Headworn team at ODG, so all of our past projects, current projects, and future projects are my responsibility. My background is, before I was a cat herder, I was actually an electrical engineer, RF, master's from South America, and I served up. So here's the ODG's history. Back in the 80s, Ralph was one of the first people that actually invented night vision goggles. So our company has had a history and a passion around Headworn. 2009 was about when Ralph hired me, and he asked me and showed me what we're doing, and the first words out of my mouth was, can't be done. Doesn't exist. The capacity isn't there. The computational power isn't there. The optical technology doesn't exist. So he laughed and he said, well, I'm doing it. I'm like, okay, then let's do it. So we tried, and we tried a lot of different designs. First design was a waveguide, prism waveguide. Second design was an even more complicated waveguide that came from the side. But what we realized with the waveguide technology was it didn't scale. Right? It was heavy. So the more resolution you wanted, the more bounces you needed. The more bounces you needed, the more tedious the design was. So it just didn't scale. So then we took a right turn around the X3, X5 timeframe, where we went to a projective folding. And you guys have to remember this, before Oculus Rift. This is before Google Glass. So we were inventing, you know, I was calling up people saying, I'm putting a computer on your head, and people laughed at me like, what is that, right? So we're actually really appreciative for what Google Glass did, because whatever your opinion of it is, it started the discussion. After Google Glass, I picked up the phone and said, I'm like Google Glass, but I think I'm better. And people suddenly were like excited. So that's the history of where we are. What we're going to demonstrate is the R7. It's our seventh generation platform. We've evolved, refined, improved, put Snapdragon inside. So why Headworn? What's special about Headworn, right? I have cool Apple watches. I have cool, as on Mario's watch, you know, Samsung watches. Why do I need it on my head? We believe the head is where all of your sensors are. You know, Ralph likes to say your eyeballs aren't on your, you know, behind. So all of your sensors, your eyes, your ears, the way you perceive the world, is mostly on your head. So the information being presented on the head is a very natural place for that. It also gives you very interesting advantages. One, it's private. You know, I take Caltrain every day. I see people's phone, Candy Crush, texting, Flickr, you know, all of that. You see it. It's not private. Tablets, same way. It's body position independent, right? A phone, it's actually pretty complicated. Leon's team has a challenge because how do you use a phone? Right? Do you use it like this? Do you use it like this? Do you use it this way? You know, are you doing augmented reality and walk around with it? Head worn, it's on your head. So as a developer, it actually simplifies the problem. Because unless something really bad happened, you're horizontal and your eyes are parallel and it's on your head. So body position independent, private, sunlight, readable. We're not competing with the environment. Right? We're not competing, the screen doesn't have to compete with a reflection. So a head-worn device can actually be more power efficient than a phone, because we don't need this massive backlight. The government version prior to this that we designed had only one tricolor LED as its backlight. So that shows how efficient the product can be. And it's hands-free, right? If it's on your head and the information is there, then your hands are open to do stuff. So telepresence, augmented reality, where you could, you know, connect with your devices, that actually becomes real. So maybe it's hubris on our part because we've been working on head-worn for so long, but we believe head-worn to be the next evolutionary process of connecting to the web, connecting to the internet. You know, back in the day, desktop computers, laptop computers, smartphones, tablets, and we believe the next generation is going to be head-worn. Problem is, how else are you going to get a 65-inch screen in your pocket, right? The screen doesn't scale, but people don't want to settle, right? I'm taking Caltrain, I want to see Netflix at a 65-inch display. I don't want to look at the, you know, small phone screen there is. So the screen doesn't scale. It just doesn't. What you've also noticed is the tablet market is actually declining. Sorry, Leon. And well, you guys are investing in what is it? That's why we're doing Snapdragon 100X, exactly. And the cell phone market, let's be honest, there's only two real major players out there, the fruit company and the Korean company. And even they are kind of struggling, right? It's becoming a commodity. Asia is going to be huge. And because of technology like the 410, the 600, cost-effective phones are becoming a commodity, but there's really nothing that allows them to go that next step. We believe head-worn enables that. With augmented reality, with the limitless screen size, with the body position independence, with the freedom to control and use your hands with the device there. And it just, you don't have to pull something out to engage it, it's just there. Market size. So this is a prediction from DigiCapital. They believe that AR and VR are going to be huge by 2020, $150 billion. And what's interesting right now is you see a lot of noise about VR because the barrier of entry to VR is awesome. It's simple, right? You put a shroud, you put a cover, you do some really good tracking and you have a VR device. But DigiCapital and ODG believes that AR, even though it's that much more challenging, is actually where the money's going to be. Because it fuses reality and the digital world. It allows for augmented vision, assistance, augmented reality. You're aware of your surroundings, so it's naturally mobile. Like a VR device isn't mobile because it's not see-through, because it's so immersive. I'm a gamer. I'm waiting for the next Oculus Rift. I will buy the next Oculus Rift, but it's a different use case. Some of the perceived competition ODG has, you know, all of Epson, Recon, HoloLens, Magic Leap, Google Glass, Oculus. And the reason I call these perceived competitions is because they're different devices, right? Look at your daily use. When you're moving around, you use your cell phone. When you're at home, you're probably using your desktop or your laptop. Right, when you're reading a book, you might pull out the Kindle. It's a different use case. The Oculus Rift is immersive. That's what it went after. Google Glass, whatever your opinion of it is, went extreme mobility. That's what they went after. So they're different devices. We don't actually see them as competition. We see them as allies opening up this new frontier in head-worn. This is the same competition, kind of broken down into virtual reality, augmented reality, immersive, and ambient assist type. So if you see ODG, this is also from DigiCapital, is in the top right. So immersion and augmented reality is huge for us. Yes, please.
So why do you think Google was able to get traction?
That's a great question. There is, I think what happened with Google Glass was that it showed this vision, and then what it actually became was different than that vision was. It showed this see-through immersive AR vision, but what it became was this information gathering, information presence. You know, they say that the leaders are the leaders are the ones with the arrows in their back. Right? Google is a smart company. They're learning, they're evolving. They're doing the next generation. They invested in Magic Leap. I don't know exactly what Magic Leap is, but they've invested. And Google, even though the market might see Google as a failure, we think it was a huge success because it opened our eyes on what works and doesn't work. You know, integration, mobility, see-through aspect, all of those were huge. Any other questions? Hope that answered your question. So what our real competition is that, right? Currently we have large tier companies, you know, the transportation companies of the world, the healthcare companies of the world. What are they using for their solution? They're using that. They're using a tablet, they're using a phone. That's our competition. Because when ODG goes to these healthcare companies and these logistics companies, we're trying to compete with a phone, right? We're trying to compete with that quality of display they're used to, their mobility, that runtime, that connectivity. That's what ODG is going after. So that's what we believe to be the competition for this space. So users are accustomed to and demand the level of sophistication that the mobile phone has enabled them to do. They will not compromise. You know, they won't go down in resolution, we believe. They won't go down in connectivity, we believe. They won't go down in horsepower, right? They expect a Snapdragon inside. They expect four cores, that amount of RAM, that amount of speed. That's what they demand, and that's what we believe the next head-worn device has to be. So here's a teaser of our R7 product. We'll go a little bit more into detail on it. The three pillars of ODG's product design is these three. Know your market, right? So it's cinema quality graphics. And we literally mean cinema quality graphics. The designers of the IMAX theaters are the designers of our optical system. So we stole them from IMAX. So it is literally cinema quality graphics. You can't see pixels. You can't see a distortion. 720p independently driven to each eye at 80 frames per second. So that's huge. Fully integrated and mobile, right? Users are used to this. There isn't a wire hanging off of this, right? There isn't another box that I need to turn on to enable this. They want it fully integrated. They want it light. And that was one of the mandates in our design. And then the last design was cost effectiveness, right? Right now we're targeting the enterprise market, but there's nothing in our product that prevents it to scale like a mobile or tablet device. And those were the three key hardware pillars of it. But in reality, for a wearable device to be successful, it just needs to disappear, right? For it to become magical, you need to not see it there. It should just be the display, the information floating in the air. And then there's something else that's interesting about a wearable device. How often is your phone off? Right? Most of the time it's in your pocket. You choose when to engage it. You go in, you pull it out and say, I'm going to engage off. And the next generation is going to be marshmallow. So we're just keeping up with the mobile device because that's our competition. That's what we're going after. We're trying to make the next disruptive mobile device. You can actually buy the product now. It's pre-ordered, $2,750 is targeted to the enterprise market because the volume is still low. As the market grows, the volume goes up, the price naturally goes down. This is also pretty robust product, maybe a little bit too robust for general consumer use. The whole front is magnesium. The optical chassis inside is magnesium. We are using some of the highest levels of plastics for the temples, so they're not corroded by chemicals and harsh environments that this device may be used for.
And you might have a quick question on
it. Sure.
So how do you see glass, you know, glass type of devices being sensors, right? Because the watch, these are sensors, right?
Absolutely.
This is taking blood pressure, heart rate, all this stuff.
Absolutely.
Will wearable like type of glass devices, will they be able, you know, what can they sense, right? Other than, because I mean, right now the purpose for that hardware is really augmenting input, but can it take output from the body as well?
Great question. Absolutely. Because of the skeleton model of the body and where the head is, we can predict behavior. We can predict step count. We can predict head. Some of our customers were in the government, they would have concussions. By wearing our glasses and the sensors inside, we could tell if they had brain damage due to an incident that occurred, either in a vehicle or out in the field. Heart rate, you know, some of the most sensitive areas of blood flow is right in the head. So it's a natural evolution of heart rate. Another advantage is we're looking at your eyes. How much bio data can a device pull from looking at a user's eyes? Can you tell one of our partners, you know, as you guys saw, potentially the mini augmented vision, BMW is one of our potential partners. Long run. We've done a technology study at Shanghai Auto Show, right? But just in general, and this is just brainstorming out loud, if you have a device on your head and you're driving and you start falling asleep, you start closing your eyes, you might have had a really good time at a party and your pupils aren't dilating properly. The system knows that, it learns that. So actually, that biometric information is all there. And it's evolutionary on how we're going to start extracting that. Yes, sir.
Can you share the IP rating, if any, with the device?
The IP?
IP rating?
On this one, I can't get because it hasn't released. The previous
the target, the target of what?
Yeah. So the previous one was IP54. We are working on.
Can you explain that?
Oh, sure. This gentleman probably can explain it better than I can. But IP rating is basically how much water and sand can it do. I forget if the first number is water, second number is sand, or vice versa. But it's basically splash proof and sand tight. So for harsh environments. We are making some basically custom variations of our current design for extreme conditions. So IP64 type of products and zone 2 products.
It's 64, not as far as 64.
Not 67 is immersion, right? I forget which one's immersion.
Sitting on a buoy on the ocean is 67.
Yeah, so I don't quote me on it. But yes, we are working.
So we are working.
It's actually very so Ralph Osterhout, our CEO, used to own a diving company. So he's very good at keeping water and fish out of devices. It's something he actually demands for a lot of our devices.
Thanks.
So no problem. Any other questions before I move on? Go ahead, sir.
The question in terms of the kind of the user experience, I think it's an amazing product.
Thank you.
I think, as you said, there's a huge future for AR and these devices. But I wonder whether it's a complement or a substitute for phones and tablets. And I think myself, you know, using the glasses for driving, walking down the street, and then when you go into the meeting, you're sitting there with your sunglasses on. How do you then transition to that?
I could have almost paid you to ask this question, which is great. So if you look at a previous generation device, the R6, they were absolutely sunglasses, right? They were a device that had 20% see-through and reflective because the customer who wanted that wanted the user not to be able to see the eye. With the R7, we wanted to be more socially acceptable. So that gentleman right next to you is wearing glasses, but it's fully see-through. It's about 80% transparent. The R7 is 80% transparent. So when information is being displayed on it, you actually see the user's eyes, but you don't see the information. So that was one of the design criteria for a product that would be used in enterprise, would be used at Dream, Dreamforce or, you know, other companies, Cisco's of the world and that. To your question about is it complementary or is it disruptive, initially we believe it's going to be very complementary. One of the best ways to control it is we wrote an app for the Android store, and we're going to make an iOS version that takes over your phone screen and makes the phone peripheral to the glasses. So you it adapts to what the glasses are seeing. So if I'm playing a video game, it turns into a D-pad. If I'm typing an email, it turns into a keyboard. So initially, we're complementary. Also, right now, we don't have cellular built in. So the way for us to get the cellular network is we go through the phone. But Snapdragon, as you guys know, has cellular built in. It's just disabled. So it's only a matter of time before we convince Leon to turn it on for us. Software. So Android is not designed for headphone. Right? We love Android because it's open source and anyone can design for it. But it has limitations. In our system, black is see-through, right? There is no color black. It's very subtle, but it has a huge impact on designing for our product. Another issue is we have dual displays, so we can actually render true 3D in space or information. Most cell phones have one display, so dual display is huge as well. How do you connect to a device that has no touch screen? Right? The device needs to learn about the user's ability. So native apps will work on our device. 16:9 aspect ratio, 720p, it'll work. But you can optimize it. So how you optimize it is the stack you put on top called Reticle OS. So Reticle OS takes that. It takes all of the user's input. It takes the environment. It takes the behavior. It takes the app and the content. So if I'm walking, my information becomes transparent. If I'm walking, my information automatically minimizes. When I stand still, it becomes fully present. So the real estate in front of the eye is a commodity, not a commodity, it's an extreme premium for headphone. So that's what Reticle OS is. It's our stack on top of Android. You're an Android developer, you can design for Reticle OS. Connectivity, so how do you control this device? Voice is a natural way. There's two microphones, a user voice and environment voice. Smartphone, any app can take over. We also thought that this device deserved its own connectivity. There's more of those in existence. Its own connectivity device. So this is a full IMU ring controller. It connects with Bluetooth Low Energy to the device. It has an optical trackpad. It has hot buttons. You could set that for an app or launching something. It has audio control, display control, and standard menu and back buttons. But when you press both of these buttons, something magical happens. The gyro inside, the accelerometer inside, the magnetometer inside, the pressure sensor inside, all turn on. And they're all MEMS-based. So I don't know how many people are familiar with MEMS technology? Great. So MEMS technology is basically really, really low energy. So a MEMS-based device, the Bluetooth Low Energy, can not be charged for a couple months and still be useful. So now it's line of sight independent because it's Bluetooth Low Energy. Now it knows my gestures and motions and activities because it has all of those IMUs built in. And it's a very convenient way to control the glasses. So this is something we invented. We're also Bluetooth Low Energy, so keyboard. Oh, yes, sir.
You say that it's MEMS-based.
What's the update frequency of the controller? So it works on an I2C bus. Do you have memorized what I2C bus update rate is? 400 kilohertz. Yeah, 400 kilohertz or something. Excuse me.
Over Bluetooth Low Energy
because it's under a HIT stack. So Bluetooth has a human interface device stack. And so we believe we're pushing at least the gyro information pretty much real time over. Told you I can pretend to be EE. Any other questions? Okay. Modularity. I don't know where that gentleman went, but he asked about IP ratings. So different customers have different requirements, right? So the heart of our system is actually this device. The board, which is right here, the Snapdragon board, you guys can come see it, put all the radios and sensors fits around this device. The optics, the camera, the microphone fit around the device. So everything you see outside of this device is industrial ID. And we did that on purpose because a wearable device is a very personal device, right? What my wife wears is going to be completely different than what I wear. What you guys wear is completely different than what Leon might wear, right? So it's a very personal device. This first iteration is for enterprise, so this is what our vision of an enterprise device is. But we left the design modular enough to have it adapt. Also, by being modular, it opens up something interesting. You could put it into other devices, right? Motorcycle helmet, natural fit. You know, if I'm riding my motorcycle, I would love for information to be present in front of me. Skiing, right? Most of the time, skiing, you're just waiting to go up the mountain. The coming down part is pretty quick, right? So while you're waiting to go up the mountain, you can check your email. You can watch a movie. You can review the run you did previously. You could be texting. So ski goggles, natural fit, right? Hard hat industry, right? A lot of these guys need to have head protection anyways. Just built it in. I'm not saying we're doing any of these, and I'm not saying we're not doing any of these. It's just showing what is possible. And then there's the airplane. One of our partners, and it's a partner of Qualcomm, took one of our glasses, the company's name's Aeroglass, and they put it on, and you wear it in a Cessna, a small plane. But suddenly you have a heads-up display that a jet fighter has. You could look through and see no-fly zones. You could look through and see other planes all augmented. And that's because you're wearing a device like this. And in a lot of ways, in the plane, that problem is easier because you're confined to that space. So tracking the user's head inside a plane is very easy. So market demand and pull. So this is interesting, and I want to put this slide in here because all of you guys are apparently developers and entrepreneurs and believe in your vision. We are not a search engine company that can boil the ocean, right? We're not a billion or trillion dollar company that I could say we're making a device for everyone at all time. So the way we approach the market, even though consumer is the eventual goal, is we dominated our niches, evolved, and went up the value chain. So our initial start was in the government, right? It was for people at borders. It was for police officers. It was for those niche markets where we got instant feedback from our clientele. We gave them a device. Some of them had to just use it because they were ordered to. Some of them wanted to use it, but they gave us feedback. We evolved. But what became interesting was that police officer, after his shift, or that border patrol gentleman who left the border, went home and suddenly became a consumer. He said, you know what was cool? I was doing this with my glasses. Why can't I do that in my home? Started pulling us. It led into heavy industry, right? We had a lot of large industrial companies, oil and gas, logistics, big healthcare companies, start asking. Same evolution. They would use it at work and then say, why can't I use it at home? Or they would use it at work and install YouTube on it and say, hey, I was watching YouTube at work. And so it starts pulling us towards the consumer. So we're dominating our niches and we're slowly evolving. Dominating our niches, slowly evolving. And for ODG, and I'm not saying it's the right way, but for ODG, that allowed us to go from a very small, fast-moving startup to a company that now has pretty good assets and is beginning to earn. And then suddenly, large companies like BMW and Mini approached us. They said, we have a passion for this space, but we don't have a platform. We believe this vision will help the driver be safer, because now I can see through blind spots. Now the cognitive load that the driver sees when driving, if the app is done right, is lower, because my eyes is looking ahead. So the information is just floating in front of me. So then suddenly that is a very interesting customer vertical. Medicine, we had a doctor do open heart surgery with our devices. Because surgeons, they're very disciplined. They have to stand in a certain way and they need to do something. But they have to constantly look up. They always have to look at monitors. With our device, he could look at his patient and the monitors were floating around him. So successfully, we believe it's one of the only head-worn wearable devices done in surgery that was used.
Good question on,
sure.
In terms of processing speed that's available today with the Dragon Board, vehicle application would be a threat coming in, right? You're entering the intersection and then also T-bone is imminent. Or if you're in the field and right, and you have, you're under fire, then you have traceability, right? Can you pick up on objects like that, or very fast moving objects like 700 feet per second kind of things?
So very interesting question. Let's just say yes. I unfortunately can't go into too much detail about that projectiles coming towards you and protecting. But automotive,
whether it's a bullet or a car, right?
Let's talk about speeds. Let's just talk about raw speeds, right? The Snapdragon 600, which is one of the embedded devices, quad core, 1.7 gigahertz of raw power. That's not using the DSP, which it has, which is just designed to do algorithms. Mm-hmm. So at that speed, you're talking about projectile moving speeds. You are talking about collision detection speeds. Inside those cars, it's probably a Qualcomm chipset in the dash of that car anyways. So now you have that power on your head more. The next generation devices, which we'll refer to as the 800XX, even more powerful, even more capable of detecting and the environment and adapting to it. There's whispers of cognitive load technology inside of the inside of the DSP. I'll let Leon on his next presentation talk about it. But there's very interesting technology in the mobile device. Hope that answers your question. Okay, so speed to market. Yes?
Sorry, just about the last slide.
Sure.
It seems like you guys are kind of expanding like what you're doing. You see yourself going more of like the modular, like you had in the slide before, as opposed to the glasses. I've done some personal design on sunglasses, and the amount of faces and head shapes, just deciding how thick or how wide the lens, how tall or how wide the nose should be.
Yes.
You can't really just make one that fits all the faces. So are you thinking more of going to a modular and then, like the lens crafters where they can go in and pick any kind of frame that they want?
Yeah, that's an excellent question, actually. So ODG doesn't really design for anyone else but for itself. We partner with key people in markets and help them enhance. So for consumer, it's a huge, just to do a consumer device, you need massive amount of funds and information and outreach. So we partner with people like BMW to go after. But to your point about the design aspect itself, do you design one iteration for each person or do you design something that adapts? So currently we're going the latter. Currently we have a design that adapts. Later on when you can come look at it, all of our ear horns are removable and replaceable. All of our nose bridges
are magnetic
and you can take them off and adapt them. Different cultures have different noises. East Asian culture, Middle Eastern culture, Caucasian, the shape of the nose, the way it fits is different. So we've enabled the device to be very modular and adaptable in that sense. Correctives, you're wearing corrective glasses right now. We have snap-in correctives. So when you put it on and you put it on the device, it corrects for the real world and it corrects for the virtual world. And even all the way to our electronics, our boards are modular. This is the processor and the PMIC. That's it. So suddenly a new generation glasses or a more cost-effective generation glasses comes around, I change one board. I don't change the system. And vice versa, this is the radio, the sensor, and the memory. So if suddenly a new type of 802.11 AD came, and I want to incorporate that in our existing board, I just swap this board. So modularity allows us to be adaptable. Long-term, is that necessarily the only path? No. But currently, that's the path we're following. I hope that answered your question.
Yeah, I was thinking more of like, kind of like a fashion point of view.
Yes.
The lens height and width. You know, some people prefer, you know, maybe a smaller glass or a larger.
Absolutely. And that's where the optical chassis part came. Yeah. So eventually, as people want different designs, your industrial designer, such as yourself, has to wrap it around this. Even our current designer, as I said, the shields are magnetic. So pop them out, so color variation, different styles is usable as well. So we're going for a modular design right now. Any other questions? Okay. So Qualcomm, an embedded program, is phenomenal. When we started, they were kicking it off at the same time, so we were learning at the same time. But if you want to be fast and you want the product to hit the market running, this is an awesome program. And for many reasons. One, the hardware options, the 410, quad core, super cost effective, everything's integrated. So if you're doing an Internet of Things or an Internet of Everything device, 410 might be a natural fit. It supports Linux, Android, Windows 10, right? So you name it, you can put it on this device. The 600, extremely powerful, quad core, 1.8 gigahertz, built-in DSP, extremely powerful device. And the 8XX is going to be a game changer, because that is bleeding edge technology that you can have access for. And what's interesting about this program is, you know, our current device is the 805. So the 805 isn't the 8XX. So what we realized as we're launching this product is suddenly one of our key component vendors for the POP decided to not make it anymore. Because cell phones evolve so fast, they're I think in a 6 or 9 month cycle, that everything that supports it goes away when that large company that's making that phone goes away. Luckily we found another vendor. But what this program allows by Qualcomm is it allows you access to everything for that chip for up to 7 years. So that's the POP, that's the radio, that's the RAM, that's the chipset. It's there for 7 years. And it's not just there on a shelf, they're evolving it. Leon's team's working hard making sure the latest version of Android runs on it. He's making sure any bugs are updated. He's making it enabled. And then the customer service and the support. Companies like Inforce, that gentleman right there, you know, companies like Intrinsic. These are state-of-the-art companies that have people in India, in the United States, in Asia. So if you're getting tier one like support, building an embedded program, and the community, right? Most of the time when we design, the first thing we do is we go to the community. Then when we get stuck, we go to a partner like Intrinsic or Inforce. And then eventually, if they get stuck, they go to Qualcomm. So this program enables a breadth of technology. Any questions you guys might have about the program? Go ahead.
No, not the program, going back.
Okay, going back.
It doesn't matter, it's fine.
Sure.
Can you comment on dynamic range and frequency response given DSP?
I can, but I don't have it memorized. Sorry. So I can tell you what chipset's inside. It's the 805. And all of its information is public out there?
No, I'm interested in your implementation because you're proposing that this could be used for Netflix or, you know, as
correct.
An example.
It is used for Netflix.
Great. But there, the quality of the sound can be game-changing.
Correct.
And so that's where my curiosity is how much time and effort are you spending on, and we can talk about this afterwards.
Yeah, we can talk about it afterwards. But let's say the 805 that I'm using is being used by the same tier one company on their flagship phone. So a lot of the open source audio files, DSP work that's available that has helped them is helping me.
What about your drivers though in the actual?
Exactly. So the display drivers were custom that we had to.
The audio drivers, not display, the audio we're talking
so,
about.
So yeah, the audio drivers, I mean, Qualcomm's chipset comes with a phenomenal audio codec.
7.1.
Do you want to speak to that about the audio? I don't have a memory, sorry.
We
don't know what it's either, but he was right. One of the advantages of what we're doing is all of these things that we have invested in mobile, now you can take them and put it in embedded devices. So you get things like audio, or even within our audio codec, people have used DSP for you guys know the okay Google type of implementation.
Yeah, but I'm talking about what the quality of the signal is, not that you can do the signal. That's what I'm trying to understand, is how far you've pushed it. We can talk later. I don't need to take everyone's time. I apologize.
Okay. Well, I think the message is that you can have this, the same level of quality of the technology on something like this that you can have on a premium tier mobile device, like a high-end smartphone.
Yeah, you're building on the mobile revolution and all advances there, incorporating it into your technology. And a lot of that work, even on the mobile guys, is actually done by the chip company. So a lot of the noise canceling algorithms, face detection stuff that you think the phone company built, I'm sure they've invested on it, but the chip company actually has that enabled. Qualcomm Advanced Audio, face detection up to 60, I forget what the number was, but all of that algorithms available to you in this program. So that's phenomenal. Any other questions about this? Guys? Okay, Mario, how am I doing on time?
It's 7:43. I think we got maybe 10 more minutes.
Okay, 10 more minutes. So I want to make sure that I go through this mini case study, demo some stuff, and then make sure answer all your questions, okay? So mini case study, it's a true story. CEO calls you in and says, hey Nima, you're an awesome dresser, I like you a lot, true story, I said, right? But we want to go to CES with a revolutionary new product. Like, okay, you're an optical scientist, which that gentleman actually knows is a really great guy, came up with a new optical design we want to showcase as a platform at CES. Only one problem, it's mid-October. CES is in January, right? How are you going to do this? What's the first thing you do? First thing you do is you call your wife and say, yeah, I'm probably going to be working over Christmas. That's the first thing you do. Second thing you do is you call Leon and say, or Leon through the proper embedded stuff, not even Leon personally, is what do you have there available as a chipset I can use? 600, 805, or natural fits, but we grabbed it, 805, right? And then you have to iterate extremely fast. In a typical company, you go what the software you want to implement will do. Then you pick the hardware to run that software. Then you put the skin around the hardware. That's a typical design, right? Hey, I want to make this app, or I want to make this robot, and I want it to be able to do these things. So it needs this type of software, so this type, no. At ODG, especially at CES, where it's something so visual, the hardware and the investor ID actually dictated what I could fit in. So mechanical was key. This is what it needs to look like. We want to look like wafer glasses. We want to look as close to wafer glasses as possible. Now, what's the hardware we could fit? Leon, what's the size of your chip? How much real estate do I actually need? What's the thickness, right? And then with that chip, what can I showcase? And that's how it went. So you iterate extremely quickly on the mechanical design. How do you do that? 3D printing is a godsend. 3D printing now allows you to print overnight, come next day, do a paper doll, see if it works, and iterate. So before you cut hard steel, before you do machining. Then proto machining gets you there. Electrical design. This embedded program gives you a reference code, the Dragon board. So that gentleman mentioned drivers. We have custom display drivers. So you take the Dragon board, you quickly spin a flex, you connect it, and your software team, they're opposite. Long term, you know where gravity is. Short term, it's very noisy. Magnetometer is a godsend because you know a physical direction. Problem with magnetometer is very dependent on the environment. Metal, currents flowing. Then you have the GLONASS GPS all built into the GNSS. So now my system knows where I am in the world, it knows where I'm looking, and it knows what activities I'm doing. We also have a pressure sensor. We have multiple thermistors, and we have a humidity sensor. So why? Why do you need a pressure sensor? Why do you need a humidity sensor? Because with the delta of pressure, I can actually tell what floor you're on, right? These devices and sensors are so accurate that I can tell 12-inch delta, right? So if I'm in a mall and I suddenly lost my GPS, it jumps onto iSAT, which uses the access points, or if we had cellular, the cellular points, and then it uses the internal sensors to say, oh, you're on ground floor of the mall. Oh no, you're on second floor of the mall. Right? So with all of these raw sensors fused together, the system suddenly becomes alive. It suddenly becomes available. And a simple stuff, like if I'm moving, right? It knows I'm moving, it dims and becomes more transparent. If I stand still, it becomes more immersive.
So it's not necessarily learning you as an individual, it's the system built into the environment.
Yeah, initially it's the environment and the behavior, but over time it gets statistical data, learns your patterns, and knows that when Bob calls, you hang up, but when Mom calls, you answer, so filter, right? The system will learn over time. But initially, what we meant is it needs to learn your environment and know how to present information to you. Any other questions? The one that was to my mom. So unfortunately, it seems like there's three sources. Should I try third one? Yay. So anyone here, we're just trying to get that up. While he's setting that up, any other questions I can answer? Yes?
What do you think will be the consumer tipping point for take up? Do you think it's around design? Is it something missing from the experience of the application?
The big threshold for consumer? I honestly think it's multiple factors. One, I think is price point, right? If the barrier to entry for price point has to be comparable to a mobile device for someone to be willing to use it. An example is, you know, if someone gave you big boots but they allowed you to fly, would you use them? Probably, if the price point is right. Second one is a killer application, right? Everyone talks about what's that head-born killer application. And we're seeing a lot of consumer verticals. Airlines, a lot of major airline companies came to us and said, I have this little old TV that's in my first class. So, you know, I flew Virgin and they put me in the upper class, which is amazing, and they offered me pajamas and they offered me a bed, and I'm like, this is amazing. And I sit down to watch a movie and it was like the crappiest, pardon my language, a really awful screen. And I'm like, what is this, right? And what are you even stowing in? And the problem is it costs the airlines a lot of weight and money.
Yay.
It costs the airlines lots of weight and money to put that in there. Right? Now imagine you come to first class, they hand you this. It's body position independent. You could be laying down, you could be standing up, you're still aware of your surroundings. Right? You're still see-through and see the activity going on, but you get this private display. So that's, yes?
A little bit about sensors. Do you plan to add something like a radar to measure distances? Laser beams, perhaps?
Leading the business up. So those are colleagues, those are colleagues of ours that make some amazing radar technology and 6 degrees of freedom technology. So if you guys are building anything on that, those two gentlemen, please make sure to talk to them. A yes, right? The future of wearable devices and even of phones and tablets will be the ability to do SLAM. Are you guys familiar with SLAM?
Sure, but 1,350
milliamp hours to do that. Well, it depends on the technology. Depends how efficient your processor is, right? If you have a processor that's 14 nanometers line width, that has a DSP that runs at 200, 300 megahertz, but it can do algorithms for SLAM very well. Yes, it's possible. Right? It's just like me to Ralph 6 years ago. Ralph, there's no way there's a head-worn device. It's not possible. Technology exists. Right now, it might be limited. But in a year, I don't think so. So SLAM is simultaneous location and mapping technology. What that means is, if you want to know where you're in a 3D space and you have a camera, you need to know where the camera is in the space. But for you to know where the camera is in the space, you need to know where the camera is. So it's this paradox. Where are you in space, but where am I? Where are you? So simultaneous location mapping is you map your environment at the same time as you find out where your location in space is. So yes, 6 degrees of freedom, SLAM, augmented reality, that's going to be huge. Is that the best you could get it? Super blurry. So it's cinema quality in there, but we have a camera. I'll quickly just demo with this. So it's real, right? It's see-through. I'm going to put the mic down, just talk a little bit.
So each display is getting 80 frames per second to each eye. And these are our applications. So we're going to start with I would do a 3D movie, but you guys can't see 3D. So I'll do UI or up movie. So once it starts playing, you notice that it's fully see-through. So you can see it, and it's a lot more see-through. Unfortunately, this camera is not calibrated properly. But the information is floating in front of you. Let's look at the light. That gives you better contrast, right? And you can control the immersion with this. Let's get out of that. Let's do, so I see my gabbing of augmented reality markers. So email, right? It's a keyboard. And again, pardon the camera and the contrast ratio, but you get full text. You get full email. You could use the trackpad, you could click, or you could use one of those connectivity methods. Let's get out of here. Let's do augmented reality. So Vuforia from Qualcomm is one of the best augmented reality. Let's start with the skeleton. Let's start with one.
And that's an application, right?
It's an application. So what it's doing is it's see right now it's just a blank screen. Let's you just see through it. But the moment there's a marker, it's kind of hard doing this, but you see how it's floating? So I'm seeing the real marker. And I'm seeing information, and it's tracked. Your laptop thing. So it's tracking the paper, right? So this is real. This isn't something I'm doing it right in front of you, right? This isn't a really cool rendering you did online. That digital world is fused with the real world. That's a real paper. As I move the paper and the information, it works. And can I get another mark? So, look, you don't change the app. Let's go to, see, a building. Imagine you're a construction guy and you look at blueprints and the actual building pops up in front of you. Or you're a gamer. If you're a gamer, right, and you could zoom in, like you could look at the town and the individual guys. But yet you're aware of your surroundings, right? This is game changing. You could do augmented reality with your phone, but how long are you gonna hold your phone up? It's not immersive, it's not there. And these are just some quick applications our guys wrote in about a week, just for a show, right? So imagine the hands of this technology in the hands of developers. Do you have the remote camera? It's in there. Show that real quick. Yeah. Yeah. No, that's the silver one. No. Sorry. Yeah. I'm going to see if I can break the universe by showing a camera through a camera. This is the first time we're demoing this, so. So this is just a Wi-Fi enabled camera from Sony, I believe. guys, right? Mm. It's the device looking at itself. Mm. Right? So quick, this is off-the-shelf Bluetooth camera. Imagine this. Imagine you're in an airport, or you're in an airline, and you're flying over Hong Kong, and on the bottom of the plane, there's a camera, and you're visualizing through the camera. Imagine you're making a home automation device, you're making an Internet of Things device, and now this technology, you know, let's see if you can get to it, not good. But, and this is just standard off-the-shelf stuff we grab. And developers and entrepreneurs like yourself, you guys can take this technology and just make it faster. All right, guys, that was my presentation. Thank you.
Awesome, Neiman. Quick question, Neema. Are you thinking of opening it up the as a platform for developers?
Absolutely, yeah. So we announced ODG's existence at Uplink 2 years ago, I think it was, Leon, because developers are so important to us, right? The hardware is just the barrier to entry. It's a software that makes it magical. So developers, we have an SDK kit, we have Redico OS development tools online. We have a huge discount on products pricing for developers. So if you want to be a developer, you can get early hardware, play with it. We're launching our own head-worn store.
So if you thought that I had a strong French accent, well, I'm sure you've seen that, of course, that video. So that should be quite understood what it was about. But basically, the way our camera works, you take a short movie, select a frame out of it, and you print it through the case. And so you hold the picture like that, and from any smartphone, you can then scan that picture and see what happened during that time. So it's like a movie that you're holding in your hand and that you can share to anybody. That's really the key of what we're doing. And the idea came up really because we're part of that young generation that lived through our whole life in a world only made of digital. So digital is really nice, but it seems like we're coming to an end. There is nothing more to add. So coming back to something that was physical was for us really important. And instant camera are magical objects. We live in a world where you have smartphones or augmented reality, lots of technologies, but when you print a picture instantly in front of someone, you still have that smile, and that's just like magic for everybody. So that's what Karen understood, and we just wanted to give it a new look, bring it to the 21st century. And we thought that augmented reality was really a way to do that. So talking about hardware, I'm sure you guys all know things have changed a lot. And it used to be that from a prototype to a product, there was a huge gap. But it seems to us that nowadays, there is a lot of step between a prototype and a product. There is continuity almost of different types of prototypes and different types of products. The way it works is that nowadays you're not just doing an idea and then going to a manufacturer to build it. you go through a lot of stages. You design your ID, and then you can use 3D printers to have something that you can hold, that you can show to people, and get some feedback so that you can iterate and iterate. So that's what we did, and we did it really fast, and I'll show you a little bit how fast we went. But just a quick word about the challenges that we had. So we started with the technology that we had, which was instant printing, and that's basically thermal printing in color. And that's a really special technology. Lots of challenges, which are like heat dissipation in the product, also miniaturization. That's just crazy because you are coming back to the mechanical era where you have a motor and you have rolls to lead the paper. So that's really hard to miniaturize. We were also talking to young users. The ones that we're targeting are Snapchat users. So for them, aesthetics, the design, it's everything. So you'll see that in our process, I won't talk much about electrical engineering. That's first because I'm not an electrical engineer, and so I don't want to get questions that I can answer. But that's also mostly because our true purpose was to lead the product with design and come up with something that feels great and that you can really, well, use in a special way. We also looked at old cameras like Leica, old Leica camera, because we thought that, well, we wanted that old touch in the print. And one of the challenges that we had also, and that we still have, is the compatibility. We didn't want to go through Bluetooth or Wi-Fi for our product. We wanted to have a USB connection so that we could use the shutter on the case so that it was faster, and also better integrability, user experience first. You don't have to pair, you don't have to do anything, you just plug, snap, and print. But that also means that we need to be phone specific. You need to have a case that is specific to your smartphone. And I'll show more about the ways we thought we could work on that challenge and what we came up with. So really at the beginning it was the concept. So we started a bit more than a year and a half ago. And at the beginning it was me, my co-founder, and Robin, our industrial designer. And it was only about, two engineers and an industrial designer, only about making that product look nice and how people see a smartphone case or print pictured. I think the good thing that we had was that we were creating something new. And so nobody could tell us, what it was supposed to look like. People were just about to tell us if what we were doing was, well, felt right or not. So that was, for us, something really interesting. And even through that first stage of concepts, we had a lot of different ideas. So the next step was to go to another step and try to get the design with a CAD model and show people what it looks like in 3D so that they could see really kind of feel the product. And we started with something that was unrelated at all with the hardware that we have and just showing the concept and ultimately what we wanted to reach. So that was one of the first concepts that we did. And then after we came up and took the hardware that we had, so that was really huge. We knew that we could work on that challenge of shrinking the size. But what we wanted to do is just build something and show it to people and have that experience of having a smile when you print a picture in something. And that worked. So we kept going on and we went through a lot of different designs, used the different type of cameras as examples that could have. So for example, that one was the Leica, and really with the leather part that you have on, we really liked that. So we kept part of that in our actual product. So the design was Alright, but as you can see here, it was phone specific, so it's only for the iPhone 5. So then after that, we thought about how can we have different phones that are adapted to that case. And so what we did is that the case was in two parts. It was one part that you boot all the time on your smartphone, and that could adapt to the actual case that was the printed part. And that was good, but then people told us that they didn't want to carry a case for our print case all around, so we needed to find another solution. So then we tried to do something where basically you could plug your case, your smartphone in the case, but the difference here is that you stick something on the back of your phone, kind of a rail, and that rail would be the one that would plug in the case. And that was good, but still people didn't want anything on their smartphone. So we had to find a solution, and then I'll show what we have. But each one of those design phases were then followed by a prototype phase. Well, those that were at least a little bit successful, actually, because we weren't printing every one of our design. Those designs that you see and that are pre-printed were done in, I think, 3 months. And we were in China at the time, in Shenzhen, so that was great because we had access to 3D printers, and overnight we could build a new prototype, and then we would go to people and tell them, okay, how do you hold it, and how does it feel like, and like, where do you put your, where would you see the shutter, and that kind of things. And really that's the validation phase that is the most interesting. Every one of those prototypes that we were making were held by at least 50 different people. And so having that kind of feedback was really interesting because we learned so many things, really simple things. One of our first design, for example, the picture was getting out of the case where the user was actually holding the case. And one of the first time, well, we understood that it was a mistake because, well, the paper got stuck. But it seems like Polaroid didn't do that instead, because the last print that they did, the paper actually comes out where you put your hand. So we'll see what happened. But it's not perfect. It's not, the name of the product is Snap. If one of you want to buy it, I'd like to see how it works. I won't buy it because I know it won't work. That's interesting. That whole validation phase is the whole purpose of what we call the lean hardware. It's kind of taken from the lean software. You just try to iterate really quickly. But the most important step, and the one that engineers really don't like, is the validation phase, where you get to talk to people. But that's the most important because that's where you learn first about your users, but also about your product in reality, how it works, and how are people using it. Sometimes they're using it in ways that you don't expect, but then you improve your product and it meets the expectations. So that's actually what we came up with, and you don't see everything because we launched the product in November, and there are some special things that we have to overcome, for example, the compatibility, also in terms of mechanical design. But basically, I think we went through 20 different prototypes to come to that point. And so the first prototypes were made only by industrial designers, and it wasn't really overcoming the hardware. But then after you come up with a better hardware, a better PCB that you can integrate, so you change a little bit the design, and then you go to the manufacturing, and so you iterate also with your manufacturer that tells you that's not possible in terms of assembly, it's not going to work. And so you add more and more people in terms of feedback, more and more users, but also more and more professionals. And that's really what is interesting when you design for IoT, is that you need to use all the tools that you have all around, and you need also to look at. Well, there are a lot of different ways, but the good thing is that a startup can do hardware and all. And I think, you know, that figure that we had at the beginning of 50% of the product will be done by startups, I truly believe it's going to be that, just because it's easy to do hardware now for startups, and it's easy to validate also and get money through a crowdfunding campaign. That's what we did. We did a Kickstarter campaign at the beginning of this year, raised a bit more than 1.5 million, and that's how we got this to the manufacturing, and that's how we're going to ship the product in November. So that's really exciting. I wanted to do a short presentation so that first I could show you some prototypes that we did. But if you guys have some questions, why I'll just put everything on the table.
You want to continue just showing the different stuff?
I'll just show you guys. So this actually is the first one that we did, and you can see that it's pretty big, and it was from specific. And then, the other ones were 3D printed. And here, you can see that we didn't care at all about how it would be assembled by the manufacturer. We knew that issue would come later, but it was just about how the product would feel, and then after figuring out how we could build it. So this one also was really interesting. That's what I was saying about having, trying to overcome the challenge of the compatibility with different smartphones. So that's where we had a specific case for the smartphone, and then that case led up to the printer part. That didn't work, so we built something where you would just plug your smartphone, and that's something that we kept. But here we changed the design in terms of having a handle, and people were saying, well, it looks like a printer. So we got back the handle, and that's much better. That's also one of the first ones here. And then being in China is also really interesting when you're iterating quickly, because not only can you do 3D printer, continuous 3D printer, but you can also do SLA. So SLA is 3D printing, but much smoother and nicer. So for example, this is one of those that we did.
Stereolithography, right?
Later.
That's all it's like, stereolithography.
Yeah, stereolithography. So it's, you can see the difference. And here, after we were starting doing some mechanical work also, how we could plug everything. And the mechanical part was also a challenge, because when you are doing prototypes, the tolerance is not the one that you have in the group, but at the same time, when you're testing mechanical, we need to have tolerance that you have in the, so that's kind of a chicken and egg problem. But that was good enough for us, so we moved forward.
So, question, Clement, meanwhile, you're doing all this, the design work is being done by CAD, or are you just kind of freehanding a lot of it, or how?
No, we were doing CAD most of the time, for example, on the products that we were 3D printing, to actually see how would people really hold it. We were putting some, just marking some people's hand on 3D printing product, and see, for example, where their finger would go, and then change the product so that, you know, it would feel better, and that kind of things. So it's a mix of CAD, but also a lot of on prototype changes and a mix of virtual and reality. You know? Yes.
So 20 iterations.
Yeah, I would say even more. Well, it is what it takes to build a product that people would like, and you avoid mistakes. And it's so easy to make mistakes when you're building hardware products.
So how does it connect? Is it through a lightning cable or through a Wi-Fi?
No, it's through a lightning. Well, it's lightning for the iPhone,
yeah,
and USB for the Android. So basically, you've got two parts. You've got the main case where everything that is mostly is inside, and then you've got an adapter where you have the Google plug and the lightning port for the USB.
Yes.
How
far through this process did you kind of commercialize the idea so understand that consumers were willing to pay for it potentially, and you'd have to drive the design and manufacturing to a cost point to make this whole thing viable?
That's really interesting, and that's a great question, because that what you want to do is go as far as possible so that the product that you show to the user is looking like the product that you're going to sell. But you don't want to go too far, because the farther you go, the more expensive it is. So for us, we went on Kickstarter in January, and the product hasn't changed much since January. It's more the overall size, but the design, how it feels like, it doesn't change. So I would say it's more a matter of the industrial design. It needs to be completed. The mechanical design can change a little bit when you are going to people and doing curves. But it's complicated, because sometimes the mechanical design can also change the industrial design. It's kind of a loop, so you can't really know. And at some point, you just need to go in front of people, and most of the people, they understand if you tell them, like, we need to change that because it makes the product better. And many things, it doesn't really look like what they bought, they accepted. Like, so remember Pebble, the one they showed on Kickstarter, it was really different from the one that you see that people work.
So what was the sort of price point on Kickstarter for the finished product?
It was $99 for the case, and it's going to be $149 in retail.
That's exactly the number I had in my head when I was going to ask the question. So I sort of wondered whether when you sketched the concept, you thought, you asked people how much would you be willing to pay for a little print photo.
That was completely part of the process. That's a mix of product design, but also business relationship. So you want to make sure that wouldn't cost more than what people would be expecting. So we also made that group so that it's not aluminum. We would love to make it with aluminum, but at some point you need to tell my industrial designer, maybe plastic is better if you want to achieve that targeted cost. It's a lot of compromises.
So what happens if I change my phone to...
So that's the point also. So when we were discussing with people, and at the beginning it was one specific, they were saying exactly that. What happens if I change my phone? So we need to make sure that you can keep on using the case. So that's why it's two parts, and there's that adapter. Because when you buy a new phone, you just need to buy a new adapter, which is $15. So it's less expensive than the new case, and you can keep on using your print case.
Just to kind of stir the pot a little bit, does the magic happen because the phone stuck to the printer? What if you were to just take the picture and have the print roll right there in your carry bag, and you'd give it instant photos? Then you'd get sort of the adapter and the phone connectivity essentially be accessible to your phones.
Well, we truly believe that's the case. That's a big difference between a printer and an instant camera. What's the difference? At the end of the day, you've got a picture. But that's not what it is. It's how it feels like. That's the user experience. And pushing a shutter and having the picture that is kind of coming up on your smartphone for people, that's just like, it's crazy. Whereas if you use a printer, it's like, oh, that's a printer again. I got that. That's interesting.
Cool. All right, guys. Presenters will hang out.
Some
more questions. I'd like to give thanks to Qualcomm, and also thanks to Richard for hosting us tonight. So
give those guys a round of applause. I did take this out. A lot of you did not come to the last meetup. That is also on Mobile Monday SV channel on YouTube. So you guys want to recap of what the driving board, all the stuff that it does in detail. We have a product version from Qualcomm going over that. And then 3 weeks from now, October 7th, we'll come back here and we're going to cover prototyping. So we're going to look at laser cutting, 3D printing, all of these prototyping technologies, how they're used, and how you can use them in your IoT project. So thank you very much for coming. We have a lot more drinks and pizza left. So please feel free to hang out. We're good here for another 30 plus minutes. Thank you. Thank you. And we're going to do the drawing. All right. We need a beautiful young lady to fit the drawing. That's right. We have a good one. Hey, Vanna, what is the winner?
Dimitri from
Jarfish? How's it called? Razor? Is it Razorfish?
Is that you?
Is he moving? He's moving his car?
Okay.
Are you sure? You're just like, hey, dude, come back, you got some awesome pizza sets.
I
get
that
dress.
You
got a
beaker,
right?
No.
Oh, how many do we have?
Just two.
Okay.
Great. Alright, the other person is Sunil from Milo Solutions. Is he here?
No. No Sunil. Alright, next.
One tape to the bottom.
Yeah.
Holly Allen?
She is on Sequoia Real Estate.
Oh, man.
All right.
Okay, here we go. Randall Fahey.
Oh.